the psalmist said in Psalm 104, verse 24, O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your possessions. Hello, children. We're making good progress on our study of the timeline of the development of life. Today we'll be moving over to the Cenozoic era, which began 65 million years ago. Cenozoic means recent life, to show that the modern plants and animals were found during that period. So 75% of the animals and plants that we saw during that time still exist today, so they're very much modern. Now, unlike all the other eras that we studied, the Precambrian era, the Paleozoic era, the Mesozoic era, the Cenozoic era has just one period called the Tertiary period. And this is a name that was left over from 18th century geologists' findings. I would explain. Now, when the early geologists were studying the history of the Earth, they named the periods into primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary. As time went on, they decided to change the names to the places, the rocks where the fossils were found of these plants and animals. So the names of the other eras were changed, and the primary era was changed to the Paleozoic era, meaning the age of ancient life. The secondary period was changed to the Mesozoic era, meaning the age of middle life. And the tertiary period was changed to the Cenozoic era, meaning the age of recent life. And the quaternary period was changed to the age of new life. But today we'll be studying the Cenozoic era to understand that period. Now, even though it was just one period, a British geologist came and realized that even this one period had five epochs. An epoch means a pause, because even in that long period of time, there were still different organisms that came at different times, different animals. So he divided it into five epochs: the Paleocene epoch, the Oligocene epoch, the Eocene epoch, the Miocene epoch, and the Pliocene epoch. So we'll be studying the Cenozoic era and knowing about the different epochs. So here on our timeline charts, we have the Cenozoic era. And like I said, it's just one period in this era known as the Tertiary period. I said to you also that a British geologist studied this period and came up with five epochs: the Paleocene epoch, the Eocene epoch, the Oligocene epoch, the Miocene epoch, and the Pliocene epoch. This division of the Tertiary period based on the geology study was named after the marine invertebrates living at the time. So all the water animals that had no backbones, he used them to name these epochs. Fossils of North American animals were so similar to those of Eurasia that scientists agree a connection between the continents had to have existed during the Tertiary period, probably across what is now called the Bering Straits. Great volcanic eruptions left lava, volcanic ash, and different types of igneous rocks over a vast area of North America. These explosions formed volcanic peaks, which included the Mountain Shasta, Mountain Hood, Lassen Peak, and Mountain Rainier. The Himalayas in Asia and the Alps in Europe were also the product of tertiary volcanism. Although a generally warm, humid climate prevailed, cold winds at the end of this period would foretell the coming of an ice age. Tropical and subtropical climates pushed as far north as Canada, creating favorable conditions for flowering plants and new grasses. The woods were thick with ferns, palm trees, and fruit trees. Ample food was available for the prolific plant-eating mammals and browsed in the forest. Two trees particularly common in the Paleocene epoch were the buckthorn, this is a plant from the buckthorn tree, and the katsura, here, the katsura tree. By the beginning of the Tertiary period, all the large dinosaurs had become extinct from the Cretaceous period. Only a few reptiles remain to testify of the grandeur of these creatures. Like the reptiles of the previous era, mammals began to invade all ambients, both the land, the sea, and air. In fact, the Cenozoic era became so abundant in mammalian life that it is often referred to as the Age of Mammals. More than 75% of the mammals that existed in the late Tertiary are still represented today. However, the only tertiary mammals resembling present-day species were the marsupials, the opossums, small insectivores, and the lemur-type monkeys. At times, primitive ancestors of modern mammals were surprisingly small. The horse and rhinoceros, for example, were the size of a dog, while the camel was only the size of a rabbit. Some of these tertiary mammals related to modern species lack the typical attributes to which we are accustomed. For instance, the horse had no hoofs, the camel was without a hump, and the rhinoceros had no horns. One of the first birds of the Tertiary period was the diatryma, a giant flightless creature that measured 7 feet in height. Its useless wings were disproportionately small for its huge body, especially since it had no tail. It walked or ran on strong, sturdy legs. Its feet were sizable with 3 toes in the front and 1 at the back, very tiny. A large curved beak enabled it to eat plants or small mammals and reptiles. Diatryma probably had feathers like our modern-day living cassowary bird, but it does not resemble any other living bird. It is possible that it was a distant relative of the crane. Marsupials were much more prevalent in the Tertiary period than they are today. Procoptodon was an enormous marsupial that lived in Australia towards the end of this period. It had a cat-like face and carried its young ones in a pouch. So a marsupial is an animal that carries its young ones in a pouch. So it carried its young ones in a pouch. A primitive kangaroo, Procoptodon mostly lived like present-day kangaroos. Now the Megatherium was the largest of the ground sloths. A sloth is a lazy person. So this was the largest of all the lazy ground animals. Why? Because it reached a length of 20 feet. It was as long as 20 feet and a weight that exceeded 10,000 pounds. Its name means great beast. This shaggy-haired creature, you see the hair just shaggy and scattered all over, carried its weight on turned in feet. You see its feet turned in, which made movement very awkward. Can you imagine walking in with your feet turned inside? How would you walk? Very awkward. So with its strong clawed forelegs, these are the forelegs, Megatherium pulled down branches and fed on leaves it peeled off with its long tongue. Megatherium, like a bear, sat upright on its huge hind legs and supporting tail. Ground sloths are classified as edentate or toothless mammals, although they never were totally toothless. These animals developed in South America but wandered as far north as the Carolinas and Ohio. They became extinct in the beginning of the next era, and some scientists think that primitive man may have been responsible. Modern edentates include anteaters and armadillos, so they do not have teeth, or they eat mostly with their tongue. The remains of an early tertiary beast called the Basilosaurus, they were found along the Atlantic coast of Africa and South America. Basilosaurus had already fully developed as a marine animal by the tertiary period. Therefore, its ancestral links are unknown and difficult to trace. An early form of the whale, Basilosaurus had its short snout, saw-like teeth, and nostrils placed high on its head. Can't really see it, but his nostrils were placed very high on his head and his teeth were like saws, very sharp. With front legs like flippers, these are the front legs, they're actually legs here, like flippers, and a long tail with flukes, that's its long tail with flukes. This enormous sea animal leaped and dived up and down through the water, unlike sea reptiles that zigzagged from side to side. So it went up, down, not side to side or side to side. The back legs of this large mammal were so small and underdeveloped that they remained hidden and useless under thick flesh. Also, in contrast to reptiles, mammals living in the water had to develop a method of retaining body heat. Eventually, their bodies acquired thick layers of fat called blubber, which provided adequate insulation. With water to support their weight, early whale-like creatures such as Bacillosaurus grew up to 70 feet in length. Wow! Early whales died out in mid-Tertiary, but their descendants, the true whales, thrived. Most of the herbivores that lived in the Tertiary period were ungulates, which means hoofed placental mammals. So an ungulate is a placental mammal that has hoofs. Present day examples include the elephant, the horse, the coney, which is also called a rabbit, the hog, and all the ruminants. Ungulates are further divided into two major groups called odd toes and even toes. Artiodactyls, or even toed ungulates, have cloven or split hoofs. Most modern herds of browsing and grazing herbivores are in this group. Cattle, deer, pigs, camels, and giraffes are examples of artiodactyls. The odd-toed ungulate or perissodactyls include the horses, tapirs, and rhinoceroses. These animals are related even though they may not seem to resemble one another. So did you know that horses and rhinoceroses were related, even though they don't look alike? The development of predatory mammals during this time forced the ungulates to become swift-running animals. The artiodactyls, called ruminants, developed a unique method of digestion, enabling them to literally eat and run. This method has proved to be successful for ruminants living on the plains today. The stomach of these animals is divided into several chambers. After chewing, the food is partially digested in the first chamber of the stomach called the rumen. It is later returned to the mouth in the form of cud to be rechewed and further digested when the animal can rest quietly. This gives the ruminant the opportunity to eat quickly on the open grasslands and hurry safely out of sight of ever hungry predators. Altecamelus here was a giraffe-like ruminant that stood 10 feet high. It lived during the Miocene and Pliocene epochs, resembling both a giraffe and a camel. It was commonly called a giraffe camel. Instead of hoofs, Altecamelus had nails with large pads underneath, which allowed it to run better on the grassy plains. Altecamelus grazed by pulling up grass between its toothless upper front gum and lower incisors. The Uintatherium was a large, massive Eocene herbivore that measured approximately 12 feet in length. It had short legs with broad hoofs instead of claws on its feet. Skin covered three pairs of 2 to 10 inch bony horns protruding from its head, while long canine tusks curved downwards like daggers from its upper jaw. This mammal could grow new teeth to replace those that grew dull with grinding. A clumsy creature with a very small brain, the Uintatherium could not compete with a large variety of new animals sharing the same habitat, and it soon became extinct. Here, the Coryphodon had a build similar to that of a modern pygmy hippo and most likely lived in the same manner. Its sturdy body grew to 8 feet in length and was supported by short legs and round elephant-like feet. Canine tusks had developed, which the males used for fighting. So you see the mouth? You see the canines? Very sharp, and they used it to fight. The Coryphodon lived near water, and marks found on its lower tusks suggest that it pulled up plants by the roots. The strong bones of these animals fossilized readily, and remains have been found in both Europe and North America. The Morytherium is the oldest known representative of a group of mammals with long noses and tusks. Its fossilized remains were found in a valley in northern Egypt, where it once came to drink and bathe in the prehistoric waters of Lake Moeris. Its stout body grew to about 5 feet in length and 2 feet in height. Its skull was like that of a tapir, with its blunt nose, low eyes, and small tusks that had just begun to develop.
It was the ancient ancestor of at least three groups of proboscidian mammals, with tusks and long snouts, including the elephant. So this is the descendant of the elephant, the Merotherium. The Paleomastodon is the oldest representative of a group of mammals with long tusks. The Paleomastodon was one of the descendants of the Merotherium. A short trunk and tusks of both the upper and lower jaws had evolved. The lower tusks were flat and shovel-like, enabling it to scoop up food from the swampy waters where it lived. The size of these mammals varied from 3 to 4 feet in height, up to 6 feet in some species that weighed up to 2 tons. Paleomastodon remains were found in Egypt in early Oligocene rocks, but the creature wandered as far as Europe and crossed Asia to North America. The evolution of the horse can be traced back more clearly than any other mammal, since its fossils are very complete and well-preserved. Ancestral skeletal remains of the horse were discovered both in Europe and America at approximately the same time. In Europe, this creature was given its technical name, Hyracotherium, because scientists thought it was related to the rabbit family. Oh, that was such a mistake. Unfortunately, this was a superficial description of the animal. Imagine thinking that a horse is a rabbit. That was the mistake that the scientists thought at the beginning, and that's why they named it Hyracotherium, which means it belongs to the rabbit family. So unfortunately, this was a superficial description of the animal. In America, the fossilized bones were more complete and easier to identify, so it was called the Dun horse or Eohippos, its common name. A primitive animal, Hyracotherium, had a tiny brain and a body the size of a rabbit. Its spine was arched and its hind legs like those of a rabbit. Its hoofed feet had 4 toes on its front feet and 3 on its back feet. So it is considered a perissodactyl or odd-toed ungulate. Hyracotherium is presumed to have lived in the forest where it nibbled on leaves and fruits that were abundant. Although this animal became extinct in the middle of the Eocene epoch, it left larger, more intelligent descendants to continue its line of development. Paleontologists, that is those who study ancient life, point out that frequently the ancestors of highly developed species are often small and insignificant. The horse is a prime example. So the horse as we know it today is very big, but its ancestors were pretty much small and almost insignificant. The first or highest animals are called primates. They are an order of mammals that includes the lemurs, tertiaries, monkeys, apes, and man. The lemurs or tertiaries are very similar to their ancestors, whereas present-day monkeys do not resemble their ancestors at all. Most primates adapted to life in the trees. To climb trees and to swing from branch to branch required specialization of eyesight, coordination, and intelligence. Primitive primates evolved with eyes placed at the front of the head, allowing the fields of vision to overlap and the animal to see one picture, clearly focused and in-depth. Most animals have eyes on the sides of the head and see two rather unfocused images, one from each eye. Early primates also developed thumbs, fingers, and hand-like feet for climbing and grasping. This improved muscular coordination and special eyesight corresponded with the growth of a larger brain capable of receiving and assimilating a wider range of perceptions. Here, the Dinofactus is an example of an Eocene early primate that looked more like a lemur than a monkey. It was probably a nocturnal animal. That is a nocturnal animal. Those are animals that come out in the night. It lived in the trees of Wyoming and had its thumb and big toes separate from its long finger-like toes. So its thumb and big toe were separate from its long finger-like toes with claws. In addition to its hands and feet, Nothactus probably used its long prehensile tail for swinging swiftly through the trees. And friends, that is the end of the Cenozoic era, which contained the Tertiary period and 5 epochs. We'll be moving to the final stage of the timeline of the development of life, where we'll finally find out how God brought man into the world.